move on to the biosafety aspect here. We have referred to the conservation, we refer to access and sharing of benefits, for which the Biodiversity Act deals with that all. Unfortunately, the Biodiversity Act does not deal with the issues of biosafety. These are governed under a separate set of rules made under the Environment Protection Act, 1986. Interestingly, the rules that were made were actually made even before the Convention on Biological Diversity came into existence in 1992. These rules were made in 1989. Of course, it was amended in 1993. But more interestingly, if you are referring to biosafety, you remember in our earlier discussion, we have found that there is a protocol at the international level called as the Biosafety Protocol of Cartagena. That was made in the year 2000, to which India became a party. But even one decade before that, rules were already made in India. And what are the rules? Rules for manufacture, use, import, export, and storage of hazardous microorganisms, genetically engineered organisms or cells. Remember the LMOs and GMOs. The same are mentioned here, as has been mentioned in the Cartagena Protocol. What is the object of this? To protect the environment and health in connection with the application of gene technology and microorganisms and cells and substances and food products, etc. A number of authorities are set up under this, which are primarily scientific bodies. There is a mention of that here in the slide. Please have a look at that. And these are the ones which at every stage of one, either manufacturing, using, importing or exporting, storing, or putting it in different kinds of application, they are the ones which will scrutinize all those activities, monitor them, give clearances or permissions, and they take a call on that. These are the authorities that are constituted for that purpose. And if there is any violation of whatever orders passed by them or whatever instructions given by them, then the penal sanctions are as provided under the Environment Protection Act, about which we have already discussed earlier. So, what we see is, it's a very interesting situation. It is an aspect of biodiversity, of ensuring biosafety as a subset of conservation. But this law is primarily administered not by the Ministry of Environment and Forest, but under the aegis of the Ministry of Science and Technology. And this has become a subject matter of great debate, contention, and even a number of court cases, because biosafety is something which goes beyond science, which goes beyond technology. And the ministry which takes care of propagation and promotion of science and technology, the one that would actually promote biotechnology, are within the Ministry of Science and Technology. It is this which has been entrusted with this responsibility of dealing with biosafety. And many a time, people have argued that the one who is actually promoting biotechnology, how can one ensure biosafety? For that, the student is advised, as part of his assignment, to refer to two important cases, one decided by the Supreme Court and another still very much alive by the Karnataka High Court. And the first case is the Aruna Rodriguez and others versus Union of India case, 2012 Supreme Court. And the other one in the Karnataka High Court, called popularly known as the B.T. Brinjal case. That would actually give you a particular idea about the biosafety regulations, how they are worked or how they are not worked, how adequate the provisions are, how adequate the authorities who are dealing with that, and things like that, part of the assignment. How do you evaluate this law? There are several praiseworthy aspects to this law. One must examine the texture, the content, and the manner in which this particular law is crafted. It's a wonderful techno-legal document. So it's not a pure law. It is a lot of technology, it is a lot of science, it is a lot of commerce as part of this legal document. And this is a law which deepens democracy far more than the 73rd and 74th amendments to the Constitution of India. Why the 73rd and 74th amendments actually created the third tier of governance in the form of local bodies, panchayats and urban local bodies, but they do not have much of an independent, autonomous existence and power. They depend either on the center or the state for transfer or assignment of functions. But here, under this statute, a body is created which has a statutory status. And it is not even a local body. It is a small unit of the local body which depends on the local body for its creation, for the Biodiversity Management Committee. And the most striking feature is to bring into existence the Biodiversity Management Committee, their local panchayat or their local urban body has a role to play. But when once it comes into existence, it will have an independent existence of its own. Even the institutional arrangements at a higher level, the National Biodiversity and the State Biodiversity Board, are very truly democratic in spirit and functioning. Their decisions are drawn from the long-standing and experience and expertise composed in the various committees constituted under it, and they give a greater feel of democracy in the real sense of the term than in any formal sense. Arguably, this is the first Indian law to recognize and reward communitarian claims. There was no such law at all in India. In fact, globally, communitarian claims are interest over resources. We normally believed in either the state power or in individual rights. Communitarian claims and interests were not much taken care of. Associated knowledges in relation to them, the traditional knowledge systems, the custodial care that is being displayed by these were never recognized or even given any right. But what you see, it's truly Indian in spirit, wherein communitarian rights are recognized. And this is a clear sign of India coming out of its colonial yoke of the common law traditions of the king as the sovereign over everything, having an eminent domain over everything. Even communities have interest and rights over resources, knowledges, and have a right over them. This is a lesson. Way back in the year 2002, for the first time, this particular Indian law gives. And corporate social responsibility is a coinage that comes into existence through an amendment to the Companies Act in this present decade, after 2010, through an amendment to the Companies Act. And that too, the corporate social responsibility is from the overflow or the profits. A small percentage should be reserved for that purpose. But here, the corporate social responsibility is far more deeper than the Companies Act. It makes it a statutory obligation that you are not going to do any charity, but it is a statutory obligation that the one that has enabled you to get these bit of profit is mainly because of a particular bioresource, is mainly because of a particular knowledge and knowledge systems that is there in India, and you have to share it with the Indian national government, state government, or as the case may be, with a local community. They are partners in your corporate activity, deeper and far more stronger than what has been provided in the company's law. These are the positive things about this law. But there are issues of concern. If we just look at the way in which this law came into existence, remember, in 1992, the International Convention came into existence, CBD. Indian law was made in the year 2002. Biodiversity Act came into existence in 2002. But bringing the act into existence is not sufficient, because along with the act, you have to come up with rules. And the rules at the national level came in 2004. That's not all. Rules at the state level also should come into existence. And believe me, that these rules were being made over a period of 15, 16 years by the state governments. So in terms of bringing the law into existence in full-fledged form, it is very recent. Although 26, 27 years had elapsed after we made a commitment to protect our and conserve our and take care of our biological resources and the knowledge associated with them. Not that all. It is not just you make the law, but even to create institutions of enforcement. It took about 15, 16 years in different states. And so the real work of implementing this law has begun just in a few years from now. When time is of the essence, the sense of urgency in making the law and bringing it into application so as to protect our bioresource, the green gold, our knowledge, to prevent it from theft and piracy, has not happened. So sense of urgency is conspicuous by its absence, is a matter of great concern. Second, this is not a comprehensive or an overarching law. It is a law of compromises. Remember that this law is not an exclusive law. It has to work alongside the forestry and wildlife law, whose mandates are different and quite not exactly in tune with what has been provided under this. And so there is always a question of adjustments and compromises, and through compromises, you actually dilute the basic objective with which you have made this law. Several laws have actually created inroads into it, like the Protection of Plant Varieties Law, or the committee that actually deals with agrobiodiversity. And there is a very interesting relationship with not just the Biodiversity Authority, but even with the ministry itself. Because in terms of its evolution, the Environment Ministry owes its very existence or genesis to a part of the Agriculture Ministry. Forest and Wildlife was part of Agriculture Ministry. And it was only in the year 1980 that was transferred to a newly created ministry called the Environment Ministry. And the shadow of the strong and deep impact and influence of the Agriculture Ministry is very much there in the working of Environment Ministry and also in the working of the biodiversity authorities. Biosafety, another area of concern, as I had mentioned a little earlier in our discourse, that it is not the cup of tea of the Biodiversity Authority or the State Biodiversity Board, except having made the rules in 1989 and amended it in 1993. The Environment Ministry has a very little say in this regard. This is actually appropriated by the Ministry of Science and Technology, and Biotechnology Department is actually enforcing it by overseeing it, by monitoring it, by scrutinizing it, and by giving approvals. And so, the objection to this is, there is a conflict of interest issue. One who promotes biotechnology, how can it deal with safety and security? It's almost like a combination of an accused, prosecutor, jury, and judge. The final word has not come from the court of law in this regard, but something needs to be pondered over and acted upon is very much perfectly in order for the Environment Ministry to consider to work on the biosafety issues. If you look at the language of this law, it's a techno-legal document, all right, but the language is a little loose and imprecise. And in law, it is an invitation to disaster. If the language is not that very clear, it gives a lot of scope for different and varied interpretations as to dilute its efforts. And here, I very strongly urge the student to do one more assignment of studying a very important case decided by the Uttarakhand High Court. The case of Divya Pharmacy in the year 2018. The gist of it is simply this, that here is an Indian company which is involved in manufacture of food items and drugs pharmaceutical drugs and other things which are derived from bioresources and the knowledges that are very much there in India. And it argued that as an Indian entity, it need not have to share the benefits derived from this particular resource because the language of the law, it tried to tweak it and interpret it to its advantage. Of course, the court said that that is not the case, that whoever who gets a commercial benefit out of this particular resource and tapping that particular talent or a knowledge or a practice or a tradition has an obligation of sharing. That will be determined by the appropriate authority, either the state agency or the central one, the national authority or the state board, through mutual agreement and on terms which are agreeable to each, based upon the conditions laid down under this law. And so there is no question of any escape or an excuse or an exception. Please do that reading as a student to understand the implications of the working of it. So it needed a court of law to interpret some of the provisions here. And when once you go to the court of law, it takes a lot of time. The law is not self-explanatory. And to that extent, the effect of the law is a bit diluted. In terms of institutional arrangement, that this is a very solid state of affairs. Because, as was mentioned earlier, the very highlight of this law has itself become a hindrance of taking governance to grassroots and making the governance of the grassroots very strong. And for that, we created under this law the Biodiversity Management Committees. But as a matter of fact, this grass is yet to develop deep roots. Even after 18 years of making the law, the Biodiversity Management Committees in all the states have not come into existence completely in both in letter and spirit as this particular law has been made, not even halfway through. And it is very crucial for an effective working of this particular law and achieving the goals set under this law. These entities need to come into existence. Actually, even for the creation and bringing into existence of state biodiversity board in more than a dozen states in India, it took more than 10 to 15 years after the making of this law in India. And biodiversity management committees are still coming into existence. And there is another serious concern that this particular ministry, which the nodal agency of which is the National Biodiversity Authority and the State Biodiversity Boards, they hardly have real, both in real time and in actual terms, cooperation from other related ministries and the usual kinds of apprehensions and suspicions that are there with other departments, other ministries, that, well, there is going to be conflict of jurisdiction or there is jurisdictional grab, and so you keep off, I take care of my part of it and don't interfere in my internal affairs or something like that. So many a time it has become a kind of a ghettoed existence that each department thinks differently from the other, and anything that biodiversity law would provide for, which actually would require the cooperation of the other agencies, it's hard to come by. And so, biodiversity law, although it is a very ideal law, wonderfully crafted, has many salutary standout features, unprecedented anywhere in the world perhaps, unfortunately, has remained a kind of, if I can draw an analogy, a Cinderella in the garment. A wonderful creation, an angelic existence, but being ill-treated and marginalized. But unfortunately, quite unlike that fairy tale end to that Cinderella, that fairy tale end is still eluding this biodiversity law and its working in India. But all is not lost. When all these great ideas germinate and develop, a lot of churning would occur within the process of the churning. And quite possibly with the pandemic that's spreading and that has actually brought the whole community of people all over the world to a new reality, crippling the economies and lives of the people in a very big way, that should actually give a great lesson to us that in biodiversity, in nurturing, taking care, protecting, conserving, maintaining and managing the way the law requires, the future of not just human being, very life rests. With that gyan, let's conclude this particular module for our consideration and then move on to the next module, in which we will be discussing about forest and wildlife law.